Well, social media was a key battleground in the 2022 Philippine polls, but it also proved to be a double-edged sword. While it allowed candidates and supporters to reach more voters, it also gave mis- and disinformation campaigns another platform. Here to talk to us more about this and social media's role in this year's elections is Dr. Jonathan Ong. He is a disinformation researcher at the Harvard Kennedy School. Good morning. Also from here in Manila, Dr. Jonathan, thank you so much for joining us here in ANC.
Yes, good afternoon from Boston.
Thank you. Actually, Dr. Jonathan, I've been reviewing and really watching all of your past interviews with all the media networks. And talking about disinformation, I learned a lot of, you know, new information, and we will discuss that later. But of course, we will talk about, you know, what's fresh. Polls are in. We see that Bongbong Marcos leads. And in line with the topic of use of social media and seeing this massive lead, what were your initial reactions when you saw the results, though yet it is unofficial?
Yeah, obviously, it tracks with the polls. Obviously, as academics, working with a lot of journalists and fact checkers, many of my colleagues have attributed some of the most aggressive kinds of attack campaigns to their campaign, right? And so that to me like triggers some kind of like an existential crisis, right? Like, so we academics, journalists, we stand for truth. We invest a lot in fact checking and voter education. So this is also a time for us to pause, like, what have we been doing wrong? Where did we go wrong? What other creative interventions can we do moving forward to catch disinfo campaigns?
What crucial elements came into play for you in terms of messaging on use of different social media platforms?
For sure. So I think if you look at the Marcos campaign on the surface, based just on his official media appearances and his select few interviews, it's a very safe, insistently safe, kind of even boring campaign on the surface. But a lot of the creativity happened online. So a lot of the brand rehabilitation happened online. So that could not have happened without social media. This is also not just a recent election thing, but it is based on 5, 6, even 7 years of campaigns. We had examples of how hashtag Ilibing Na, the Marcos Sr. burial in the Hero Cemetery, was also coordinated online. So this is a long-term project. It's been very patient and also very creative. It involved a lot of influencers, amateur video production, YouTube channels, the works. And this could not have happened were it not for social media.
You know, in the event that this, the trend of the results will soon pan out, and if this will become official, of course, in the future, we just don't know when. And when you think about the strategy, right, that this certain candidate has really planted, it's not just about 1 year, 2 years, these elections. And you've mentioned that this has been, years and decades of work. What do you think was the maybe thinking back then when they were starting this? And
yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they've been very patient. I think of the Marcos family in mainstream appearances, even in like arts and culture events, like art gallery shows. They had once been treated as pariahs, like in elite circles. Like in academic forums, people have been canceled for inviting them to events. So social media, in a way, enables them to create an archive to rewrite history, right? So, and that's why journalists and fact checkers are sometimes their targets, but really their ultimate target is history, historians, academics, and how their project of rebuilding and rehabilitating their brand, again, could not have happened were it not for social media. Some of them started as professional productions of the golden age of martial law. More increasingly, it became more like amateur TikTok productions. They all come together and create like this archive that people could draw from to participate in Marcos folklore, Marcos myth making. I don't see people exchanging this as, you know, passive or dumb voters, but this is actually creative and participatory. People enjoy, you know, feeding each other conspiracies and also playing into the victimhood narrative of the Marcoses, right? So positioning themselves as victims of history. They also try to create that as a story of relatability. So this is how we relate to the disenfranchised. We can relate to you from our own position of victimhood. And it's a false victimhood performance.
Now, Dr. Ong, just from a generic standpoint, when you talk about information and when you talk about execution, of course, when it comes to Facebook, those have different types of executions in terms of posting or content. When it comes to TikTok, you have these 15, 30-second or one-minute videos. What do you think is the strategy in terms of, like, if you are a PR and if these... Mm-hmm. I know that you've mentioned this in your previous interviews, mm-hmm. that you know, clients, quote-unquote, employ PR firms to be able to hand out content. What do you think are the main differences between Facebook or TikTok?
Yeah, so TikTok is very interesting for this election cycle. We have not seen TikTok play out in previous election cycles. So TikTok is unique because of its viral sensation kind of quality in its algorithm. So as long as you post regularly to it, its playful algorithm rewards you with a viral sensation kind of dynamic, quite different from Facebook and Instagram, where based on like your follower count, you can kind of predict the reach and engagement that you can have with a certain post. But TikTok is very playful, and that's why it rewards like younger and original and very consistent content producers. So we have examples, including a study that they authored for the Philippine Center for Investigative Journalism of blatant misinformation and conspiracy theories in these TikTok accounts that have not yet been deplatformed. So I think that is important to call out that they should be doing faster takedowns as compared to Facebook and other platforms, because again, the virality of the TikTok algorithm is very unpredictable, inconsistent, but also, quite rewarding for its patient content producers. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you're right to say that I have done studies where I actually interviewed trolls. Yeah. We interviewed trolls. We wanted to hear from their own words.
I got to listen to some excerpts. I got to listen to some excerpts from your podcast. Right.
Yeah,
go
thank
ahead,
you.
Doc.
Yeah. And so the title of the podcast is Catch Me If You Can, co-hosted by Kat Ventura for Puma Podcast. And if you want to hear trolls, PR operators, influencers tell us about how they got into political operations, how much they're getting paid, please listen to our podcast. And you will be surprised where they come from and how normalized they make it sound.
Now, just a follow-up question from what I asked previously. When you talk about the demographic, has that also been a part of your studies where you want to create maximum impact when in terms of communicating with your audience, right? For example, this candidate is the brand and you want to be able to maximize the reach. In this specific elections, and when you talk about these platforms, where do you think do these candidates concentrate the most?
Yeah, so that will depend on the candidate themselves. So for local candidates, it's important to be investing in Facebook groups and Viber groups because that can be very geographically targeted, right? Of course, TikTok caters to the youth. And obviously, like some campaigns, the Marcos campaign was credited to be investing in TikTok quite early on. But again, it depends on the kind of platform. So Viber and Facebook Messenger are very important, and Facebook groups are important for local campaigns. If you want to talk to, you know, the titas of Iloilo, for example, there's a Facebook group dedicated to that, and some might be creating fake accounts to really infiltrate some of those groups.
All right, so when we talk about disinformation and played a key role in terms of planting seeds in the beliefs of its audience, and when you see the results, can we connect the dots now? Does this, you know, do you think, Doc, that does that give a chilling effect?
Yeah, so I think that's a fair question to ask about the real impact of social media. So even though I'm a communication professor, I'm not a technology fetishist. Like, I don't blame, you know, Facebook for brainwashing passive voters. I don't blame TikTok for duping passive youth who don't know any better. I think the discourse of the bobotante who are brainwashed by social media is very dangerous, disingenuous, and not accurate. Right. So social media, what it really does for politics is to really create fandoms and to treat politics as a game of political fan groups, and such that the quality of campaigns in 2022 was extremely vicious. Right. Like, we see the other camp as our enemies, not even as people we disagree with, but our enemies to be obliterated, to be vanquished. And I think that makes for a really nasty and vicious kind of political discourse. So rather than thinking of social media as changing people's minds, it's more reinforcing of their existing political predispositions and beliefs.
I'm also curious, Dr. Jonathan, I know that you've interviewed, just please correct me if I'm wrong, about the head boss troll, head
yes.
troll. Yes. And, yes, you know, these yes. are employed by, you know, PR firms. And of course, there's an ethical issue with regards to that. But when you talk about maybe the future of the industry, has that come into play on that kind of issue also?
It's good that you're asking this, Migs, because this is a very tricky and thorny, challenging issue of regulation, right? And a lot of journalistic reports, a lot of fact-checking, even academic research, to me, emphasizes troll hunting that targets the easy targets, that targets the lowest level troll or the lowest level influencer. Even, you know, Senate investigations will tend to kind of name and shame the blogger, the queen of fake news, the influencer. But who exactly are the boss trolls? Who are the top trolls? These are powerful people in advertising and PR firms. They hold corporate accounts and also political accounts. They're also protected by their political clients. Their political clients have a sense of gratitude, a debt of gratitude for helping elect them into office. So they are kind of protected. What we need here are transparency mechanisms in advertising and PR to regulate political marketing, not for the Wild West that it currently runs, but, you know, to create more transparency about it. I'm not advocating for censorship here. I'm not advocating for a completely punitive or legal approach, but about transparency. Are these people paying the right taxes? Are these people running clean and honest campaigns? Are politicians declaring the spends that they pour into influencers? Currently, they're only declaring spends for advertising, but not for influencer marketing. As we have seen in 2022, the spends for influencers and social media account creation has really skyrocketed. But we currently do not have the systems for that. And we need academics collaborating with journalists, collaborating with BIR and legal experts to help solve this complicated issue.
Well, of course, when these PR associates, as you would call them, you know, they create massive content, and when they get uploaded to these platforms, it is up to the people if they're going to consume it, whether they believe it or not. Do you, in your studies, Doc Jonathan, are there people, or maybe Filipinos, know the truth? You know, they discern, they know that what they watch, they consume, they know between the truth and not, but, you know, they chose the other way.
Yeah, that's such a good question. It's about the psyche of the voters, the psyche of the Filipino public. I think, you know, and even with truth, right? Like, I'm thinking about the weapons of, you know, academics and journalists, our weapons of, you know, education, fact-checking, like, are these enough? I'm increasingly thinking about, you know, how we also need to, you know, sell the truth and create persuasive stories. Also stories that are inspiring, right? And I think that's where we kind of like fall back on. It's like, how can people not believe in the truth and the singular truth? And we take it for granted that our students would, you know, subscribe to this. But we need to be persuasive. We need to be inspiring. We also need to listen. And I think... Vice President Robredo talked about the beginning of a movement that was started. I was really inspired by their imperative for listening that their grassroots campaign started, you know, about listening to the other side, having open discussions and open dialogue. I don't think we've been doing this enough. And I think the Robredo campaign did it just a little too late, to be honest. But I do hope to see more consistent efforts for listening, for open dialogue and discussion to really understand why are people believing the things that they do and voting for the people who are, you know, don't have their best interests at heart. What are the compromises that they're really having? So these are really tough conversations and could not happen. Like, we can't provide an alternative story and a persuasive alternative to these people without understanding and meeting them in the first instance.
You're right, Dr. Jonathan. VP Lenny, Vice President Lenny Robredo, addressed that in some of her campaign speeches when she was being attacked, especially earlier in her vice presidential career. She would just ignore it and not, you know, face it head on. But, you know, she mentioned that she learned her lesson. Perhaps if there's one thing that she should have done more is by taking that head on right away. And
I agree.
Right. And, you know, yeah, go ahead, Doc.
Yeah, I agree. I also talk with human rights activists and human rights workers, and they express the same thing. When President Duterte would attack human rights principles, sometimes they just let it pass rather than directly address it and to respond with a counter narrative. I think that's what the opposition, that's what liberal politicians and Democrats also don't have, you know, an alternative, an inspiring counter narrative that will affirm shared futures, that will propose an inspiring vision for the future that is truly inclusive and empowering for the disenfranchised and the marginalized. That's what's missing. So far, we rely too much on these are the facts. You should believe in the facts. We're going to fact check you, right?
Right.
That's not enough.
Well, jumping off from this topic, because there are now two tales. You have one when you are being attacked by fake news, you would just ignore it, compared to you would counterattack it. But why do you think is the initial reaction of a person being attacked is just to let it slide, knowing that it's not true, so he'll just ignore it. What are the differences now of those two approaches?
Yeah, I mean, Amigs, we are mentally exhausted, like our emotional, mental health, like we are really exhausted, right? So when people, you know, just let something slip past them, nakakapagod to be responding to troll attacks one after the other. When I talk to with my students, like, sir, is it correct to starve the troll or patulan ba the troll? And I tell them, do what's healthy for you. Like, sometimes it might be best to, you know, have a social media detox and have conversations offline. That's okay. Do what's best for you. I think we've been really worn down over the past 6 years by our toxic and vitriolic political culture. And I don't want to blame ordinary people, you know, for the choices that they do if they want to, you know, distance themselves from toxic conversations.
Yes. Dr. Jonathan, perhaps you may have answered this in the previous programs, but for our viewers now currently tuned in to ANC from all over the world, how are social media platforms being regulated, and how do they address this?
Yeah, I think that's a really challenging issue, social media regulation and regulation moving forward under the front runner, Bongbong Marcos's regime. What could we anticipate, right? In different democracies and also illiberal democracies around the world, there's challenging new legislation where social media content is being dictated on by the government. And I think that leads towards censorship. And of course, the Philippines, like, we have direct experience of censorship under martial law. We don't want that to happen, right? So we don't want social media content policy to be dictated by our lawmakers and politicians, because as we have seen, right, in 2022, the people behind disinformation campaigns are politicians themselves. So Right. What we need are more civil society bottom-up interventions that could be guiding platforms around some of these decisions. And I think platforms need to be treading carefully moving forward, whether they're gonna attribute, you know, this network belongs to, you know, certain politician. If maging hostile yung relationship ng platforms and ng politicians, it might actually be even more dangerous for us down the road, for free speech and dissent.
Now, given that they have the will to do so, and considering the massive amount of content that are being uploaded on all platforms regularly, have you some updates, mm-hmm. or maybe in your recent talks with them? If you have, what are they currently doing? Do they have the infrastructure to actually mm-hmm. fact check every yeah. content that are being uploaded?
Yeah, so I think so. Some of it is content moderation and content policy. So content moderators are these digital janitors, right, who scrub hateful speech online. So platforms do say that they have invested in more local content moderators who can check on also non-English, but Filipino speech and speech in dialect. And I think that's a good thing. That's obviously not been enough. They need to be doing that much more quickly and aggressively. I also think that one thing that platforms have been doing, especially Facebook and Google, have been to fund and support local fact checkers. So I think that is a media freedom kind of initiative to support local media and local journalists. However, we have heard, including the presidential frontrunner and their family, to be quite upset by fact checkers for being so-called biased. And so we need to be watching that space very closely if pressure gets placed on our fact checkers and local journalists who are receiving some kind of financial support from social media platforms like Facebook and Google.
What do you think is the view of the international community to the Philippines? Is this somehow a carbon copy of what happened in the US in their previous elections?
Yeah, I think, you know, the experiences of the Philippines offers, you know, a trick mirror, a circus mirror to other democracies around the world, both advanced democracies such as the US, but also democracies in the global south like India. The experiences that we're having here are fascination, are fantasies for authoritarian and strongman leadership. It's not unique to us. Sometimes, and I get upset, including my colleague Nicole Corato, gets upset when, you know, the story of the Philippines is often just exoticized. Why are people voting in a certain way? Why are the masses, the Bobotante, voting a certain way? We want to challenge that, right? Because it's like, look at the US, look at other countries, the same experiences are also being reflected. This is not specific to the Philippines case. And I think that needs to be very carefully thought about. And you know, authoritarian and strongman leaders get confidence from seeing each other win. So, right. You know, a victory for a Trump is a victory for other strongman leaders like Modi, you know.
All right. So if, you know, jumping off again from that, if this will be the results right now, do you think that we are some sort of a case study for other countries to emulate?
Wow. Yeah. I hope that what they will be emulating, you know, two things. The authoritarians can emulate the playbook that was not innovated, but I think was reinforced and held as an effective example here. And they could be learning tactics here around, you know, historical revisionism, brand rehabilitation, long-term strategy in terms of, you know, sanitizing, you know, dictatorship and things like that. You know, progressives can also learn good lessons about the grassroots volunteerism and creative social movements of the progressive campaign here. And again, the emphasis on listening, of reaching across the aisle and having open conversations. I mean, here in the US, where I currently live, right? Ganun din, parang it's a very cancel culture dynamic. We don't want to listen to the other side. We want to just deplatform the other side. rather than have open conversations. And I think it's really challenging to be having these conversations, but we need to be reflecting on what are inspiring stories that we could help, you know, advance and inspire the next generation to buy into. And I think it requires like a lot of careful introspection and reflection and self-criticism, you know, rather than blaming voters. It should be also a reflective exercise. For me as an academic, I'm a teacher. I talk to students here in the US. I talk to students in the Philippines. I have to reflect, what am I also doing wrong, right? I stand for the truth. I stand for education. I stand for media literacy and teaching people how to consume social media. Maybe I have been doing wrong things too. So I think that honest acknowledgement is something that we need as a society to be doing, and progressives around the world should be doing.
Where do you think will that come from? And how will that happen?
How will that happen? You know, having tough conversations, not to shoot down conversations, not to, be defensive about things. It's easy to be defensive about things. And even with my own colleagues, it's hard to criticize each other. I mean, we're all like very weary and exhausted. And again, our mental health is very fragile right now. So I understand, the need to detach and to stay within easy conversations, but I think it's important to have tough conversations moving forward.
Now, as a parting shot, Dr. Jonathan, this is a two-part question. Given if Bongbong Marcos will be the next president, or given, like, let's say, of course, basing from the polls, it is top two, Bongbong Marcos and Lenny Robredo. First one is, given if Bongbong Marcos would be the president, what would the online world be? And the second one would be, given that Lenny Robredo would be the president, what would the online world be? You can start with Bongbong Marcos.
Yeah, with Bongbong Marcos, I predict like a more stratified media and information ecosystem where certain platforms and certain media channels and certain journalists and influencers will be granted exclusive access to the halls of power to report about official affairs, while other platforms and news channels and the more critical journalists will be marginalized and stigmatized. So we will be seeing a mainstreaming of alternative influencers. They will become more mainstream. They will become more more propaganda channels, while the mainstream media now would become the alternative. So a reversal, if you will. Under VP Robredo, I would see more lobbying for social media platforms to be much more aggressive in terms of their takedowns, in terms of transparent content policies, and to have more support for local journalists and liberal media. So that's my prediction.
All right, there you have it. Dr. Jonathan Ong, thank you so much, as always, for joining us here in ANC. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much, Migs.